I would like to say good morning to everyone, to all the serving officers, members of the USI, and to the Chief Guest, Marshal Soman. It is an honor for me to stand here and give a talk about this particular book, The Westland War Team, the Indian Air Force. And I will not take too much of your time. I would just like to go over how this idea came about and what this book is actually about. Almost every book about the Indian Air Force would somewhere have the phrase, the AF was formed with a flight of four aircraft in 1933. The aircraft was the Westland War Team. And beyond this particular single line, there is not much that has been chronicled in terms of what the aircraft was about, who flew it, how many units flew it. So even though there are a lot of photographs around and a lot of sources around, there hasn't been an attempt to chronicle the history of this particular aircraft. One of the surprising thing is, even in Great Britain, which one can say is the mecca of aviation history in terms of books and publications, you will be hard pressed to find a book or any literature on this much neglected aircraft. Part of the reason is it is not a glamorous aircraft that that captures the public attention. We're talking about the Supermarine Spitfire or the Hawker Hurricane that fought and won the Battle of Britain. This looks like one of the old Kabadiwala aircraft that was rescued and given to us in India. So not many enthusiasts or historians were interested in chronicling this particular aircraft. But this is the Indian Air Force first aircraft, and we love it with all our heart because it is our first aircraft. And that was one of the reasons that this entire process started. My interest was to see, how this aircraft was used by our number one squadron in 1933, and over the years, who were the pilots that were flying it? What were the pilot experiences in flying this huge, this large biplane aircraft that was much larger than your average tiger moth or your regular moth series biplanes? So just I was essentially collecting this material only for my personal collection, and I was very fortunate at some point of time, like a few years ago, to have this idea, maybe I can put this together into some sort of a book. And I had a vague idea as to maybe I will document the history of each individual aircraft. And a turning point was when, out of the blue, I mustered up enough courage to compose an email and send it to Squadron Leader Ramachandra and said, "Sir, what about you? Is it a good book idea?" And he didn't have any hesitation. He said, "You know what? This is something that can be built up into." And he was very encouraging and positive about what it could turn out to be. And thankfully, due to the grant from the USI CFHR and General B.K. Police Trust, we were able to start our serious effort to work on this project and finally see it through its conclusion. A brief word about what this book is about, how it is structured and all is that, as I mentioned, there are a few articles out there about this particular aircraft, but none of them actually talk about how the IAF operated it. So this book, in the initial chapters, talks about the aircraft in terms of the technical features of it as it was in the early 1930s, and that particular section is followed up by individual unit histories. Not many people know that when you say the Wapiti, people usually think of number one squadron, and at some level they will think of maybe an additional squadron or two, but the Wapiti was operated by a lot more units of the IAF. Hundreds of pilots actually learned training. I mean, they completed their advanced training on this particular aircraft. So we have units like number one squadron, two and three. They were flying schools like the SFTS earlier it was known as the flying training school. And finally, there were about a whole batch of like six flights that were raised between 1939 and 42 on the IAF Volunteer Reserve Force. These flights were designated as coastal defense And they were stationed in important ports and cities like Vizag, Karachi, Bombay, Cochin, and Madras, St. Thomas Mount. Again, not if someone would trace the lineage of some of our squadrons, like 101 squadron or 102 squadron, you could actually go back to the CDF flights, which were numbered 1 to 6. And at some point in 1942, from orders under the Air Headquarters, they were renamed 101 flight to 106 flight. And that's how the numbering system continued to the disbandment. And post 47, we had these units, new units, raised as 101 flight, 102 flight, 103 flight, which are current squadrons. So the aircraft was operated by all these units and the for a total period of about 10 years, from 1933 onwards to 1943. And of course, by 1940s, it was obsolete, it was long enough to then, most of the aircraft are falling to pieces. Still, a whole generation of pilots trained on this. So this book covers the units that that flew them and also the personal recollections of some of the flyers of that time. Due to the time that has elapsed, like almost 80 years, very few veterans are with us. And I can only recollect two veterans who have flown the WAPT, Marshal Arjun Singh and Air Chief Marshal Idris Latif in Hyderabad, both of whom have published some recollections on how this aircraft handled, and that is provided in the book. In addition to the unit histories, I've taken a new approach in which I have traced down each and every airframe that flew with Indian Air Force or had some contact with Indian pilots, you know, in terms of training or during the army cooperation or whatever. So the history of each individual airframe has been provided with appropriate photographs where possible, and there were a total of almost like 66 aircraft, individual aircraft that we have identified, and some of them had some very colorful histories. There was an aircraft that was used, that was flown by Vice Marshal Maurice Barker in Vishakhapatnam to track the Japanese fleet that came in Bay of Bengal. Then there was an aircraft that Marshal Arjun Singh flew, and there was another aircraft that he actually had to force land in Wana. So all these histories are pretty much collated and presented in this particular book. Just to give you some snippets as to what is inside the book in terms of content. The cover is of course by Derek Burns, which was specially commissioned by the Society for Aerospace Studies by Mr. Pushpinder Singh. It was very gracious enough to lend this us for the cover image. And what it shows is a flight of two Westland operatives being flown by pilots of number one squadron, doing what we call the proscription raid. Attacking a village that belongs to the hostile tribes of the Northwest Frontier Province. Now this might seem a little barbaric, you know, in today's world, but even then the rules of war were pretty much followed. Any bombing raid was always preceded by lots of warning to these hostile villages. Leaflets were dropped, announcements were made saying that, you know, you should evacuate your village. This was usually done as a punishment for some kind of an attack that was carried out on a convoy. Indian Army post. So this painting sort of captures that era of the frontier flying using the WAPT. So while researching this book, there were some fantastic discoveries that we made for the first time. Now everybody knew that the IAF was formed in April 1933, but are there any records, are there any existing written or, you know, government records that actually chronicle what happened in the first month? I was very fortunate during the research to look at the logbook of one of the RAF pilots who was attached with the IAF squadron. What this particular page shows is the very first flights conducted in the Indian Air Force after it was formed. Now there were only two pilots when it was formed, the commanding officer Squadron Leader Boucher and his flight commander H.P. Broad. And what you see is the logbook of flying officer H.P. Broad, and it shows that he was taking around all the Indian Airmen on air experience flight and some training flights. And so this is the only existing record that you will find of the very first month of the Indian Air Force operations. I should also mention that when the Indian pilots like Air Marshal Subrata Mukherjee or A.B. Awang and the other joined, they joined 2 months later, somewhere towards the end of May. So even their logbooks would probably start with the month of May, but this is a very unique document that that was discovered as part of the research. Now, this is a very sad photograph of a wapiti. My apologies for the spelling mistake there. Of a wapiti with the tail number J9754. The location is sort of has a significance for me because this was taken at Visakhapatnam, which is where my mother comes, which my mother was born. And I'm from AP, so anything that has an Andhra connection is of interest to me. This wapiti, even though it's shown in towards its last stages of its life, where it was being dismantled by a repair and salvage unit, was also flown by Air Marshal Maurice Barker in 1942. He had the distinction of being of discovering the Japanese fleet that had intruded into the Bay of Bengal to carry out attacks on the Indian forts. So he and his observer were, you know, they sort of tracked the force for almost 2 hours and reported it back to Vizag. And India was actually better prepared to cope up with the Japanese strikes. So again, you know, this is one of those unique photographs that were discovered as part of this the research effort, never before published, and you see it for the first time in the book. Now, this is sort of an ordinary photo, but the significance of it is that it came directly from the collection of Air Vice Marshal C.A. Bhushan, who was our first squadron commander of No. 1 Squadron. Bhushan was a flight lieutenant when he was transferred from the RAF to the IAF, and he was told to, you know, form this A flight of No. 1 Squadron. And, you know, as part of gathering the picture and collecting the material, I was fortunate enough to establish contact with A.V. Bhushan has passed away in 1977, but his wife is still alive. So I was fortunate enough to establish contact with her. And this was done the, you know, your regular old style by writing a letter, handwritten letter, and she responded back with a handwritten letter. And she very graciously sent me this photograph and said, "These are the photographs that I have. You are free to keep them and use them with you." So it had a special significance for me because it has passed through the hands of A.V. Bhushan and Lady Bhushan, and finally it is, you know, it has ended up with us. Something that even caught my attention was this writing on the back of the photograph, which I would like to believe was A.V. Bhushan's handwriting, but it requires some verification before I can claim that. So these are the sort of amazing discoveries that we made while looking for this, while researching for this book. And I'm actually glad that today to see the product in its final form. And the thanks in the no small measure go out to the USI and CFHR and all the staff and folks who supported this particular venture. With this, I would like to say thank you, and I would hand over the rostrum to Area Commodore Vikram Singh.